Hi everyone, this is Peter from Birds of Play, and welcome to 5 Things to Fix, a series where we try to find faults with some of our favorite games, thereby engaging with them in a different way from how we usually experience them. In this video, we'll be taking a look at one of the often more overlooked titles in the Final Fantasy series, a game filled to the brim with political intrigue and interesting new approaches to game design within the series, the wonderfully vast and excitingly experimental Final Fantasy XII. If you end up liking the video, or if you're just a fan of Final Fantasy in general, and would like to sign up for more content, don't forget to subscribe to the channel, and tell us if there's anything in particular you would like to see. And who knows, we're still such a small channel, you might even have time to make your wish come true. But now, with the customary groveling out of the way, let's get to talking about the 5 fixes for Final Fantasy XII. Fix number 1. Van. When it comes to fixes for Final Fantasy XII, Van is sort of the elephant in the room, with a lot of players taking issue with the character, even though his abs have now been fixed. Some people might say he's whiny, but the bulk of the criticism directed at Van has to do with how inconsequential he is to the story, and how quickly he gets sidelined by the other characters. It's somewhat praiseworthy that Van didn't receive a lore upgrade later in the game, telling us he was actually the rightful heir to the throne of Delmasca all along, or something like that. His humble beginnings are in fact what gives the character what little weight it has, Van serving as a reminder to the ruling class that wars aren't fought with chess pieces. It's just a shame that Van doesn't speak from the heart more often, ultimately being more of a reactionary character, making not only himself but also his relationship with the other characters superfluous. Just look at this piece of concept art for the game. In what world is this picture representative of Van's actual relationship with Princess Ash? They look like they might be lovers, or at the very least, on fairly friendly terms. It is, however, less likely the player will get that impression from actually playing the game, and in fact, Van's general motivations and relationships remain quite blurry throughout the game, his admiration for a particular sky pirate aside. But maybe the main problem isn't that Van is lacking in some way, but rather the fact that he's set up to be the main character. A role that carries with it a host of expectations Van was seemingly never designed to live up to. You don't even have to look very far to find better alternatives. Princess Ash being on an epic quest to save her kingdom, Bash being a hero branded as a traitor, and Balthier being a charismatic sky pirate that even calls himself the leading man. Compared to these three, Van is, well, relatively bland in comparison, even though he does get a few moments in the spotlight. There are a lot of parallels between Final Fantasy XII and Star Wars, and the player would be forgiving for expecting Van, the street rat that dreams of flying, to play a similar role as Luke Skywalker, the farmer boy that dreamed of, well, flying. Van's destiny, however, isn't as grand as Luke's, so even though there are some similarities, Van has just as much in common with C-3PO, being a relatively minor figure in the grand scheme of things, that nevertheless finds himself in a position to witness history unfolding before his very eyes. The fix I would like to propose, however, isn't about improving Van or cutting him out of the game altogether, but rather to give players more control over how much they are meant to relate to him, or perhaps more accurately, control over how much they have to look at his ass. Final Fantasy XII does do a commendable job of letting players customize their party of choice, even going as far as letting them bench Van indefinitely. No matter how much you choose to neglect Van in favor of maiming as a different character, however, once you enter a city or some other settlement, you'll be forced back into his boyish blonde body. This might be important for the story at some point in the game, which I wouldn't mind being forced to play as Van, and I usually don't. Most of the time, however, the story would make just as much sense if I could opt to run around town as some of the other characters. The fix is therefore fairly simple. Don't force me to play as Van in towns and cities unless there is something in the story that demands it. If you're going to make me look at asses, at least let me pick different classes. Fix number 2. Quickenings. Quickenings are Final Fantasy XII's version of the Limit Break system, a system that has had various names and function in different Final Fantasy games, such as the Desperation Attacks from Final Fantasy VI, Trance Mode in Final Fantasy IX, and Overdrives in Final Fantasy X. These moves have often been synonymous with the characters being in danger, or being pushed to their limits emotionally, only being available at the moment the line is actually crossed. Just like with limit breaks in Final Fantasy X and overdrives in Final Fantasy X, however, quickenings are something you can actually walk around with and save for a special occasion. Just like all that pent-up anger you have welling up inside of you, waiting for the opportune moment to lash out at an unsuspecting bystander that just happens to be there at the very moment your life starts to unravel. Although, unlike the victims of your misguided rage, quickenings in Final Fantasy X are most often reserved for appropriate targets, with monsters out in the field typically not being strong enough to warrant not only the power of the quickening, but also the time it takes to execute them, meaning that these super moves are almost only ever used on bosses or powerful hunts. When all is said and done, quickenings just aren't all that quick. It's very easy to name some problems with this system. First of all, the sheer amount of time that goes into watching the same animations play out again and again can be quite tiresome. Secondly, the quickenings might be said to be fairly overpowered, often bringing bosses to their knees with a single wall-strung chain. But this problem with quickenings might actually also be their main strength, presenting an alternative way to fight bosses in Final Fantasy XII. Most of the fighting in Final Fantasy XII is done by utilizing the so-called Gambit system that lets players customize the action commands of the party and essentially program how they want individual characters to respond to different situations. This relegates the burden of micromanaging the party to the Gambit system, and when done effectively can completely automate combat. Case in point, the first and only time I beat Yiazamat, an optional super boss in the game, I set up my gambits and started the fight. Then I went out to see a film in a cinema, while leaving my PlayStation 2 running, and when I came back, not only was Yiazamat alive, but also my entire party, fighting all by themselves, just like I had programmed them to do. The level of automation the Gambit system offers can be quite satisfying, but it can also be rather passive, so it would be nice to have a viable alternative. The problem is that just performing quickenings can in itself be quite passive, even though it requires some fast reflexes at regular intervals in order to get the next step in the chain going. In order to make it a bit more action-oriented, however, so it would pair better with the Gambit system and offer the player more choice when it came to their playstyle of preference, the fix I would like to propose is having quickenings require more input from the player. Perhaps something as simple as some of the overdrive mechanics from Final Fantasy X, having players push a correct sequence of buttons like Auron, hit a button at the right time like Tidus, and maybe even play with some slots like Walker. Aesthetically speaking, at least Balthier seems like a good candidate for some slots, even though that might not be my favorite gameplay mechanic. Just don't make me rotate the analog stick like Lulu. I don't want to ruin my controller or the palm of my hand. Fix number 3. Hunting for meaning. Final Fantasy XII introduced the concept of monster hunting to the Final Fantasy series, something we've seen in every subsequent mainline installment since. In Final Fantasy XII, the inclusion of hunts makes great use of the vast and open nature of Ivalice, the world of Final Fantasy XII, often making you go out of your way to search for your marks, thereby familiarizing yourself with the world in ways the story itself doesn't emphasize directly. The hunts can also present a fun opportunity to challenge yourself by fighting powerful enemies for sport and reward, each successful hunt netting you some payment for your hard work. At the end of the day, however, I can't help but ask myself, what was it all for? Since all I seem to do is come back home with blood on my hands and little context for it. You do get some backstory on the hunts, but it doesn't feel substantial enough to warrant all the hassle, aside from some of the final hunts that are quite satisfying, not only from a gameplay perspective, but also in regard to the story associated with the hunts. But it all feels like too little too late. I do understand that there are probably people at the opposite end of the spectrum that love hunting just for its own sake, beating super bosses such as Yiazamat, affording them the ultimate bragging rights, much like taking down Ozma in Final Fantasy IX or Penance from Final Fantasy X. I nevertheless wish that the hunts would have more wider appeal by offering more of these story-driven moments. Not necessarily for every hunt, but at least regularly enough to keep me interested. Like I said, the last few hunts accomplished this quite well, but it didn't really feel worth it since that was all there was. When Hansel and Gretel went about leaving a trail of breadcrumbs, they didn't just strew them around the witch's house and call it a day. No, they covered the entire length of the road they took, much the same way I would want the hunt to whet my appetite early on, and keep me engaged, not solely by relying on the gameplay aspect of it, but also by mixing in some story. Delicious breadcrumbs. This is especially important in a game like Final Fantasy XII, that has a very dense and linear story, but a very vast and open world. This often results in players losing touch with the main story, since they're too busy doing other things the game has to offer. If those other things were also satisfying in terms of offering more of a story to go with them, maybe players wouldn't be as quick to judge Final Fantasy XII as a game that puts its otherwise excellent story in the back seat. If you're going to make me hunt my mark, at least prepare a story arc. That's a good one. Fix number 4. License to kill. In order to acquire new abilities in Final Fantasy XII, you must first acquire the proper license from the license board. And don't worry, it sounds a lot more bureaucratic than it actually is. In practice, that just means that you spend ability points in the menu in order to unlock passive and active skills to be used in battle. Even though it might not be the most efficient system for letting everyone strengthen their characters in the game in an optimal manner, there's a lot of fun to be had navigating the board. And there's something to be said for giving players the freedom to mismanage their points and choose skills they won't be able to use for a long time, or won't ever use since they are outdated by the time they finally get around to them. This can often be the case with equipment, since what types of weapons and armor you can equip is presented as a passive ability on the license board. A system like this can have some humorous outcomes, such as buying a hat but being unable to actually wear it until you acquire the correct license. All in all, however, it's interesting enough to have its own existence in the game justified, so I wouldn't want to get rid of it. I wouldn't even dare suggest changing the system itself. Therefore, it's time for the nitpicky fix. What I would like to see implemented is a way to acquire new licenses at the same time you're shopping for new items or abilities. The reason is that it can be a real hassle to go back and forth between the shop screen and the license board just to figure out whether you could hypothetically wear a particularly fancy hat or equip a more powerful weapon. I'd even be satisfied if the shop screen only allowed you to unlock a license for a particular piece of equipment if you had already unlocked the adjacent license. Although I could also envision a system that showed you the total ability points you needed and would even let you select multiple licenses automatically if you were really set on making use of something, be it a particular ability or a piece of gear. I'm ready to pay, just make my day and give me an easier way. Hey! Fix number 5. Take your time. With the release of Final Fantasy XII, The Zodiac Age as a definitive vision of Final Fantasy XII, the original game has practically been lost to history, with no way to play it short of playing it on the original PlayStation 2, or by other less savory means. Since The Zodiac Age is generally an improvement on the original with updated graphics and a more engaging class system, the loss of the original isn't felt as strongly. Another improvement is the abolishment of forbidden chests, wherein opening some seemingly random chest meant that you wouldn't be able to acquire the most powerful weapon in the game. However, it also means that I won't be able to relive my precious memories of running underleveled into the Necro Hall of Nabudis, evading enemies left and right to get my hands on the Zodiac Spear. But oh well, the times they are a-changing. But speaking of spears, or better yet swords, and not just any swords, but those double-edged swords in particular, there are some improvements that have been made to the game that also have a bit of a downside. In the case of Final Fantasy XII, The Zodiac Age, my greatest friend is also my biggest enemy. And now I am referring to the added ability to speed up time, having you run around areas faster than you can accurately control where you're going. This is a fantastic addition to the game, making grinding a lot more bearable, and making replaying the game a lot more manageable. Maybe even affording players some extra time to spend with their friends and family in the real world. But sometimes I don't want to spend time with friends and family. Sometimes I just want to play a Final Fantasy game without feeling like I have to rush through. I know I can simply choose to ignore, but actually there's nothing simple about it. The game has been drastically altered from the way I originally played it, and I hate myself for loving. So, for the first time in the history of 5 Things to Fix, the fix isn't actually for the game itself, but rather for those of us playing it. We need to be responsible with the power afforded to us, and not fall victim to the guiding hand of the game, bringing the reins of fate back into the hands of man. Thanks for watching 5 Things to Fix for Final Fantasy XII. If you liked the video, don't forget to subscribe, leave us a comment, and I'll see you next time. Birds out.